Yeah, the goal for the next few lectures is to understand the largest eigenvalue of Gaussian random matrices in the right scaling. This has a very important distribution, which is called the Tracy-Wilhelm distribution, and that's something which we want to understand. So this topic is about the statistics of the largest eigenvalue. So up to now we only have looked on the global behavior of all eigenvalues together, but have not really looked on separate eigenvalues. But now we want to look on single eigenvalues, and in particular the largest one, so the statistics of the largest eigenvalue. And this has a very specific distribution, which is called Tracy-Wilhelm distribution, according to the two people who showed this, so Tracy-Wilhelm. Distribution. Good, okay, so what we consider, and I mean this Tracy-Wilhelm distribution is something which is a kind of universal object which shows up in many contexts, but if you really want to calculate it, or at least get some grasp on it, one really should look on the ensembles which have a very nice analytic structure, and that's the GUE or the GOE, because there, both on the moment side and on the analytic side, we have very precise formulas. So what we are going to do is we consider the Gaussian unitary ensemble, or maybe the Gaussian orthogonal ensemble. And what we know, of course, about the eigenvalues is the semicircle law. So we know that for large n, the eigenvalues converge to the semicircle. So for large n, the eigenvalue distribution is close to the semicircle. Okay, so maybe let me draw a picture. So here's the semicircle. This goes from minus 2 to plus 2. And the semicircle law tells us that if I'm taking an interval here, and I want to ask how many eigenvalues of my GUE are in this interval, then this is very close to integrating this density over this interval. So it's very close to what I have here. But of course, we are scaling our eigenvalues or our matrices so that the eigenvalue distribution lives on the interval minus 2 to plus 2, which means if I'm looking on such an interval, if n is getting larger and larger, how many eigenvalues do I have here? It's something which is proportional to n. I mean, I have n eigenvalues in the whole interval, so this means on also finite pieces here, I also have something which is proportional to n. So this means what I'm seeing here is always the average over many eigenvalues. Okay, but now I want to ask the question, what happens if somehow I also make this interval smaller and smaller, going with n, so that essentially I have an interval which contains maybe on average only one eigenvalue. And I want to ask, what can I say about this one? And of course the semicircle law doesn't say anything about this. It doesn't know about single eigenvalues, because they don't contribute in the limit n going to infinity. Good, okay, so the density of the eigenvalues, which we have here. And so we want to look on maybe single eigenvalues, and actually the behavior of them is different depending on whether I'm in the interior or at the edge. So usually the guy here, where I'm far away from the edge, this is called the bulk of the distribution, and if I'm somewhere here, this is called the edge. And the statistical behavior of the eigenvalues in a bulk and at the edge is different. Okay, and so what we want to understand is essentially what happens at the edge, and in particular, we are looking on the largest eigenvalue. I mean, this is very precisely to define. If you are inside here, maybe it's not so clear which eigenvalue you want to consider. But the largest eigenvalue is a well-defined object. So, and the question is, what happens with the largest eigenvalue? And the semicircle law, I mean, it tells me this is largest eigenvalue cannot go much below 2. Okay, because I mean, otherwise, I would stay away from the boundary here. Okay, but of course it can go above 2, and the semicircle law doesn't prohibit that it can be as large as it may be. Because I mean, in the semicircle law, each eigenvalue only counts with mass 1 over n, so in the limit, specific eigenvalue doesn't contribute to the eigenvalue. Huh? Good, okay. So I mean, in particular, we want to see that actually the largest eigenvalue really is very close to 2. Huh? It's not that the largest eigenvalue is somewhere here, but really the largest eigenvalue also converges to 2. But then in particular, we want to scale down and see its behavior around 2, how it fluctuates. So if we zoom in, then of course, then we will, if I realize it, if I have different realizations, I will get statistics of this eigenvalue around 2. Okay, and this statistics in the right scaling is given by the Tracy-Widom distribution. Okay, and that's something which we want to understand. I'm not saying proof, because to really prove all the details is very tough. But we want to get some idea what is behind this. In particular, we want at least see that the largest eigenvalue really converges to 2. Good, okay, so what we are going to do is, so we will zoom to a microscopic level. With this I mean a level where you see somehow single eigenvalues, not just the average over eigenvalues of the order n, and try to understand the behavior of single eigenvalues. Yeah, okay, and maybe just we say the behavior in the bulk and the edge is different, but we only talk about the edge. We only will talk about the largest eigenvalue. But of course, there's also interesting things to say about the bulk, but I'm not addressing this. So the behavior in the bulk and the edge will be different. Are different. And so we are particularly interested in the largest eigenvalue. Yeah, good. Okay, and in particular, that's what we will prove, is that the largest eigenvalue really converges almost surely to 2, which is not covered by the semicircle law. So, in particular, we will see that this largest eigenvalue, lambda max, converges to 2, but we will also try to understand a better understanding. If we are zooming in, what is the fine structure around 2, how it fluctuates, and that the Tracy-Widom distribution. And at least I want to give some ideas about what we expect for this. Good. Okay. But so maybe the first thing is that one should get an idea of the right scaling. So namely, if I have an eigenvalue around 2, and I mean I'm zooming in, so how should I zoom in so that I see something which survives in the limit? So what is the order of the fluctuation around 2? Maybe that's the first thing which we should think about. And then many calculations we are doing will show us that this is the right order. I mean, I'm just now giving some heuristics, what we're expecting for the order. And then later on we will see, if we do rigorous estimates, that this is compatible with this heuristic idea. Okay, so on single eigenvalues. Yeah, so let us check what is the typical order of fluctuation of the eigenvalues. Okay, and for this we essentially assume that the semicircle really is also true in the microscopic behavior. So it really gives us the approximate positions of the eigenvalues. I mean, of course, this is not really justified at the moment, huh? But somehow, I mean, we know eigenvalues repel each other, so they should essentially they should be spaced very nicely, huh? And maybe even on a low level, this goes with the semicircular behavior. Okay, and so maybe there we should distinguish about the behavior in the bulk. Okay, so in the bulk, so now I'm looking on interval, but this is a small interval. So essentially I want to have a, I mean if I'm taking here an interval, which I'm keeping fixed, if n is increasing, then I'm getting more and more eigenvalues in this interval. And now what I want to know, what is somehow the typical size of an interval where I can expect just to see one eigenvalue. Okay, and that's somehow the order for which I expect the fluctuations of this eigenvalue. That's the room which it has available for its fluctuations. And so if this semicircle distribution would be true on this level, yeah, then I mean, in, let's say I have here an eigenvalue and I go here to lambda plus t. And then I mean, I have here the semicircle, which of course is really flat here, more or less, if this here is very small, if t is very small. So then I'm looking on the interval, let's say from lambda to lambda plus t, and lambda is just somewhere here in a bulk, and then I'm looking how much t should I add to get an interval where I might expect one eigenvalue. So how many eigenvalues should there be in this interval? There should be something which is proportional to, I mean, the density of the semicircle here times the volume here. And the volume here, this is t times this here. I mean, this p of lambda is not really changing on this level. So this means I would expect to see t times p lambda times n. I mean, that's the ratio. I mean, I see n, if I'm integrating over everything, and I see n times the volume of such a guy if I'm just looking onto this. So I expect to see so many eigenvalues. Okay, and if I want to see one, then this should be of order one. So this is of order one. Okay, this is of order one if I choose the p of order one over n. Okay, so I should make my interval of size 1 over n. It should shrink with 1 over n, so then I expect that I have just one eigenvalue in this small interval. Okay, so this is of order 1. If we choose t proportional to 1 over n. Okay, and this is somehow the interval which this eigenvalue has available for its fluctuations. So this means one eigenvalue in the bulk has for its position interval of size which is proportional to 1 over n. Of course, I mean, there are factors, 5 over n, or so I doesn't care. I just want to see what is the behavior in n. And so this is somehow a good guess for the fluctuations of the eigenvalues. Good, but we are not interested in a bulk, but we are interested in the edge, and there the situation is different. So let us see what should we expect at the edge. Okay, so if at the edge, I mean, there the semicircle, I mean, that's where the semicircle goes down, actually as a square root behavior, so 2, 2. And now I'm looking on interval from, let's say, 2 minus t to t, and I'm asking how many eigenvalues should be there. And again, I want just to have one there. Okay, so I'm looking now on an interval from 2 minus t to 2. I mean, that's the interval where the largest eigenvalue should be sitting. So there should be roughly how many eigenvalues. So again, I have n times, and then I should take the area below this curve. So I should integrate from 2 minus t to 2 the density of my semicircle over this interval. And the density of the semicircle is 1 over 2 pi times the square root of 4 minus x squared, which of course I can write as 2 minus x times 2 plus x square root dx times n. Okay, so there I should have roughly so many eigenvalues. And again, if I want to have this of order 1, so what do I get? To have this of order 1, I essentially want to equate this to 1. Maybe let me continue here. So I want that 1 is approximately, okay, I mean that's this 1 over 2 pi, I mean those constants don't play a role, but so I'm taking this integral, but in this integral, dx is close to 2, and then of course this guy here is close to 4. Okay, so this doesn't play a role. Only critical thing is this 2 minus x, which is close to 0. So this is approximately, so I'm taking this 4, more or less I'm taking it out of the integral, and then I'm integrating from 2 minus t to t, just the remaining square root of 2 minus x dx times n, and there of course I'm getting an integral, so this is 1 over I had the square root of 4 there, I just got a 2 here, so I have here 1 over pi, and then I have to integrate the square root of 2 minus x, and this is 2 minus x to the 3 over 2, I get some factor, and I have to integrate this from 2 minus 2 to 2, so the primitive Stammfunktion of the square root to 2 minus x to the 1 half is 2 minus x to the 3 half with some guys here. Okay, and so if I, okay, at 2 this vanishes, so what I get is just two-third of t to the 3 over 2. I mean, those constants don't play a role. The only question is, what is the power of t? So I mean, I have the t, so 2 minus t is t to the 3 over 2. So this means this here, t to the 3 over 2 times n, this should be of the order 1. And that's what we now actually expect as the size of the interval, which the largest eigenvalue has for its fluctuations. And that should be, should is too strong. I mean, that's maybe a good guess for the size of the fluctuations. But of course, this is not a proof. This is just giving us the idea of what could be, and it's somehow it's still a miracle that it's really this is really the case. So and if we do this scaling, then we really get a distribution. Okay. So from this, we expect that 1 should be of the order t to the power 3 over 2 times n. Or to put it the other way, t should be of the order n to the minus 2 over 3. So in the bulk we had n to the minus 1, here we have n to the 2 minus 3. So this means that the largest eigenvalue has more room than the eigenvalues in the bulk. Not size 1 over n, but size 1 over n to the 2/3. Good, okay, so this means we expect for the largest eigenvalue an interval where it is mainly sitting, and maybe that's also the size of its fluctuations, of this size, which is proportional to n to the minus 2/3. Okay, or maybe very optimistically, we could even think that maybe the largest eigenvalue behaves approximately, so it's 2, but then around 2, it has fluctuations of order n to the minus 2/3, and maybe then these fluctuations are given just by distribution which does not depend on n. So maybe this x has at least a limit distribution. Okay, so this, where this x has an n independent distribution. Good, okay, so this is very rough, very heuristic, and maybe there is no, on this level, there is no real reason that we really might expect that this has to be true, but it turns out this is really the case, and so actually the maximal eigenvalue really behaves like this, and this guy is essentially the Tracy Willems distribution. Okay, so let me just formulate it. So in a sense, that's the miracle in this context, that all this is true. So namely, this is indeed true. So one has, namely, the following limit, which we denote by f. And I'm putting a beta here. I will say something about this soon. So this is the distribution function of the Tracy Willems distribution. So this should be the probability from minus infinity up to some point x. And this is the limit for my matrices, if n goes to infinity, of the probability that in this scaling, n to the power plus 2/3 times the maximal eigenvalue minus 2. So if lambda max goes with this scaling, then I should subtract 2, then I get this, and then I multiply it with n to the 2/3 just to get this distribution here. So that this distribution is less than x, this really has a limit. Okay, and the point here is this limit exists, and that's what is called the Tracy Willems distribution. Or this is the distribution function of the Tracy Willems distribution. So this limit exists. And this distribution is called Tracy Willems distribution. And of course, Tracy and Willems also gave some formulas for this. I mean, here it's just the statement, there exists a limit, but of course you would like to be able to calculate it, and I will say more about this later. Good, but in the new assignments, at least, I mean, you are asked to plot histograms of this and really to see that there is something there. You get something for n, it really converges to something for which you can produce pictures. But there is no, I mean, the point is, there's no very nice direct analytic formula for it. So it's not like a Gaussian distribution for which you can write a density, but this is very involved. It can be described in an analytic way, but this is quite complicated. And I will give some ideas about this. But this also means we will not really be able to derive all the details about this. I can just give you some ideas. Good, but let me make, before we try to go in this direction, let me make a few remarks. In particular about the relevance of this. You might say, okay, this is for this specific, maybe specific random matrix ensemble. Maybe if I look on other similar problems, there are many more distributions. But the point is, somehow this Tracy Willems is a kind of universal distribution which shows up in many contexts. Okay, but before I talk about its universality, I should also say that it is sensitive to some details. And this is this beta, because this beta here tells me which of my ensembles I consider, the GUE or the GOE, or maybe the symplectic one. So, and there are different results in those cases. So it really depends on beta. So the first is that one should note that this Tracy Willems distribution really has a parameter, beta, which actually is 1, 2, or 4, corresponding to the three ensembles which we have. This corresponds to, I mean, if I'm looking on the GOE, then beta is equal to 1. If I'm looking on the GUE, this is the O, orthogonal, GUE, the unitary case, then beta is equal to 2. And if I'm looking on the quaternionic corresponding matrices, the symplectic ensemble, then beta is equal to 4. I mean, beta is usually used in its context because the density in terms of e to the minus trace of a squared something, you have different coefficients there depending which ensemble you have, and this is usually written in terms of beta. So it's beta times this, and if you plug in those betas, you get exactly the densities for this. Okay, so this means, so that I'm putting the beta there means that in those three cases, I actually have different distributions. I mean, the scaling is always the same, but the limit scaling, the Tracy-Wilhelm distribution, is different for the orthogonal and the unitary case. And also in the assignment, you are asked to plot histograms for the orthogonal and the unitary case to see that you get different results in those cases. So it turns out that statistics of the largest eigenvalue is actually different for the real complex and quaternionic Gaussian random matrices. Okay, for those four ensembles. So this means on this microscopic level, somehow the situation is more sensitive to which ensemble I consider. On a macroscopic level, I always get a semicircle. It doesn't matter whether I consider real or complex or even quaternionic Gaussian random matrices. The overall distribution always converges to the semicircle. So there is no beta there. Okay, but if I'm zooming in on one eigenvalue, then suddenly it makes a difference whether I have the real or the complex ensemble. Okay, so in this sense, there is more sensitivity there to those details of the considered ensemble on this microscopic level. Good. Okay. And actually, I mean, in physics, usually, whether I choose one of those corresponds to symmetries in physical systems. So it really it makes somehow sense to consider this instead of this. So often, for example, the GOE is used for a system where you have a time reversal symmetry. Okay, so usually those goes with the symmetry of the underlying physics. Good, but anyhow, I mean, for us it's just different ensembles, and on a microscopic level, the fluctuations see this difference. And so you might expect that, I mean, this is very much contrary to universal behavior. It means it depends on details of your random matrix model, and so you would expect that, if you are changing other things in your random matrix model, you would see different Tracy-Wilhelm distributions or distributions of the largest eigenvalue. But this is actually not true. So namely, if somehow you are fixing beta, somehow fixing the symmetry, fixing that you are looking on complex random matrix models or that you are looking on the real ones, then suddenly if you are starting to change things, the distribution of the entries, you're looking on Wigner matrices, or maybe you even go over to more general matrices, it turns out that then on this microscopic level, this doesn't have an effect. On a microscopic level, really this distribution is universal. So it really it's independent of much of the concrete nature of your considered random matrices. And much more universal than just on the macroscopic level. So we also had some universality for the semicircle. We could go over from Gauss to Wigner, which means we still keep the entries independent, but we just change the distribution of them and we always get the semicircle. And this universality also we have on a macroscopic level, but you can even change more. Okay, and that's what I want to say, and that's really the why this distribution is so important, because it shows up in many, really in many different situations. And understanding this is, I mean, still is a kind of problem. So it's not, there is no meta theory which really would tell you or prove that you get Tracy Widom in big classes of systems. No? But you can, for specific systems, you can prove that you see it. You can also do numerical experiments and so, but it's, at the moment, we are still missing a meta theorem which tells you here, for this big class of things, we Tracy Widom. Good, okay, so. So that's part two, is about the universality. So on the other hand, when beta is fixed somehow, beta is fixed, there seems to be large universality class. Universality class for Tracy Widom. Universality class means there are many models which give you always the same Tracy Widom distribution. Okay. And so for example, so this F beta shows up as the limiting distribution in, for example, the following models. And of course, the first, let's say I take beta is equal to 2, so then it's the GUE, and I mean that's of course where Tracy and Widom calculated it essentially. And we know we have a lot of analytic structure on GUE, so there one is really able to calculate this distribution here. So this is Tracy Widom, and this goes back around 1993. Good, then of course we can go over from the Gaussian to the Wigner matrices, which means we still keep the independence of the entries, but they are not necessarily anymore Gaussian distributed, but now they can have an arbitrary distribution. So that's the Wigner matrices. And for those, we also know that we get a semicircle on a macroscopic level. And on a microscopic level, we also get this Tracy Widom. And this is a quite non-trivial result. This was shown by Soshnikov around 1999. Okay, and of course, for Wigner matrices, you don't really have a precise analytic description of their joint eigenvalue distribution. And there, essentially, what you're doing is you're showing that if you want to calculate this distribution, then you show that it is the same result as here. So you write down somehow expansions, and you see the dominating contributions are the same as here. You argue away the other ones, so you know it's the same result as here. And here you know it's Tracy Widom. But you're not really able to calculate Tracy Widom here. It's more that you see this gives you the same result. Good, and then there are more random matrices, and actually random matrices which don't have Wigner distribution in the limit. So there are also general unitarily invariant random matrices. And I mean, those are essentially of the form that the density which you put on the matrices are of the form you have the exponential, then you have minus V of, let's say x squared. So the density, if for the Gauss, we have here e to the minus x squared. So then we take the trace, so we take minus n times the trace of this. That's the density. For the Gaussian, we put here the quadratic potential, so it's just x squared, but you can put here other polynomials. And then you get matrices where the entries are not independent anymore. Okay, but they still have the feature that they are invariant under unitary rotations. So maybe general remark, the GUE, the Gaussian unitary matrices, they have two important features. One is that the entries are independent, and the other one is that they don't change if you do a unitary rotation. So they look the same in each basis. Okay, and you can generalize each of those features, but not together. If you keep one of them, then the other will be lost. Wigner matrices keep the independence of the entries, but they are losing the unitary invariance. Okay, and the other extension is you look on random matrices where you still have unitary invariance, but then you are losing the independence of the entries. Okay. And also for those, and I mean those matrices, they don't have the semicircle as a distribution. They have other distributions. So on a macroscopic level, you lose universality if you go over to those. But on a microscopic level, you still see the Tracy-Widom distribution. Okay, and so I mean this was one of the big result that also to prove universality for this was something which took quite a while. So this was done by Percy Davitt and co-workers in the years around 94 up to 2000 maybe. And this was one of the big results there. Good, okay, but then actually it's not only random matrices where you see this distribution, but there are other problems which also show you the same kind of behavior. And I mean, some of them you can relate somehow with random matrices, but in a non-obvious way. But others, maybe it's not even so clear whether they really are related to random matrices. Okay, and maybe let me write down a few more of the names appearing in this context. And maybe the next big result after those random matrices was that if you're looking on random permutations and you look on the length of the longest increasing subsequence, which a priori has nothing to do with random matrices. It's a different problem. So namely, you're looking on the length of the longest increasing subsequence of random permutations. So again, you have a parameter n, which is the size of your permutation group. You look on permutations of size n. You look on all permutations, so all of them have the same probability. It's a finite number, n factorial. So each of them has a probability 1 over n factorial. And then for each of them, you look what is the length of the longest increasing subsequence. Then this length will be a random variable. And you can ask, does this have some limit description? And this was considered for quite a while. And when all those things here came out, then it was suspected that actually, in the right scaling, this is the same as the length of the largest eigenvalue of the GUE. Okay, and this was finally proved, again, one of the big results, around 2000. So this was one paper by Baik, David, and Johansson in 1999, and then another paper by Okunkov around 2000. And actually, there were several proofs. But again, it's relating. I mean, relating what happens in these random permutations with the eigenvalues of random matrices. But you have to go through a lot of bijections, particular ISK algorithm, and so. So maybe at some later point, I will say a few words about this. But this really shows, I mean, this is a totally different regime. So maybe you are not so surprised to see this Tracy-Widom distribution in random matrices, but it seems to be even more universal. And maybe there are also, for example, another thing are the fluctuations of the Arctic Circle for the Aztec diamond. So this is a tiling problem, which maybe you should look up what this really means. Again, this is a problem which looks very different. So you're trying to tile with some dominoes, some region, and then you have there are fluctuations around some specific configuration. So this was proved that again there these fluctuations in the right scaling in the limit have the Tracy-Williams distribution. This was proved by Johansson around 2005. And then there are also various growth processes which model somehow the growth of a polymer or something like this. So models in physics, where some parameters like the height or so also show fluctuations which in the limit are given by the Tracy-Williams distribution. So there are various growth models. Essentially you have some pieces falling down and then the next sticks to what is already there in with specific rules. And then you get a growth of a polymer or something, and you can ask what is the height of this. This is a random process, because what is falling down is doing it in a random way. Okay, so you have various growth processes. And I mean there are things which are called as the ASEP. So this means asymmetric simple exclusion process, or there is TASEP, which means totally asymmetric simple exclusion process, and so on. I mean, okay, I'm not going into details, but there are things which really look very different from the very beginning than random matrices. Good. Okay, and so somehow the general feeling is that this Tracy-Williams is a universal object, somehow like the Gaussian distribution. The Gaussian distribution is also kind of universal object, but there we know quite well why it is so universal, because it shows up in the central limit theorem. So it's really the sum of many small things which are independent, and then you get the Gaussian distribution. And here, one would hope that there's also an explanation of this type for the Tracy-Williams distribution, that it should also maybe be the result of something like a central limit theorem. But of course, you don't have independent things, but I mean, you have guys which are dependent in some sense. I mean, like the eigenvalues of random matrices, they are not independent, but they repel each other. So if you do have this kind of repulsion, then maybe you expect something like this for the largest quantity which you have. But I mean, that's the idea which people have in this topic, but the point is there isn't—it's no way of making this really rigorous. So a theorem like this is missing at the moment. The feeling is there should be something maybe like this, like a central limit theorem. But what really should you assume, and which covers all those different classes? Okay, so this is still—I mean, this feeling is around. I mean, in the 2000s, you see this was a very big topic with the big results, but still, there are many new results on this. But this idea that there should be a mega central limit theorem or whatever is around since the 2000s or so, but nobody has been able to make this really rigorous. Good. Okay. And then maybe the last remark which I want to make here is that, part of the problem is, of course, that this is analytically quite tough. It's not like independent random variables where things are very smooth to prove, but it's really getting very hard, and we will not be able to really calculate Tracy-Williams. So it's not easy to calculate the limit of those distributions. So you need a lot of precise analytic information, but then going to the limit is again something which involves a lot of mathematics which is somehow beyond us. So I mean, even it's not just a matter of one or two extra lectures which I could do to do this, but probably one would need a whole term to do all the basics which is behind this. So I'm not really proofing Tracy-Williams, but I will try to give the ideas that we see why we expect at least formulas which we have. Good. Okay, so let me write this down. So proving Tracy-Williams for the GUE is out of reach for us. Not just for you, but also for me, is out of reach for us. but I will give some ideas. Okay, but in particular, I mean, the ideas will in particular show that this heuristics with this n to the minus two-third fluctuation, this is the right one. And in particular, what we will be able to show is that the largest eigenvalue converges to 2. But of course, this is much less than Tracy Widom. Huh? This is more classical result, but still it's... it's it's interesting and relevant. Give some ideas. In particular, we will show that lambda max converges to 2. The largest eigenvalue converges to 2. Good. Okay, but now, so we should now become more concrete. So we want to see somehow fluctuations around 2. And I mean, for our control of the eigenvalues of the Gaussian random matrices, essentially we had 2 different type of tools. I mean, one was the moment method, the combinatorial one, where we calculated traces of powers. And the other one was really looking on analytic descriptions. And for the GUE, we had a very precise formula for the joint eigenvalue distribution in terms of determinants. So, I mean, in principle, we have a very precise analytic formula, and we just should do some scalings on this and go see what happens with this in the limit. But this is not easy. Okay, and so I will later talk more about this analytic approach, but at the moment, maybe we are going back to the combinatorial approach, the moment approach, and try to see how much information can we get out of this to see what is the behavior of the largest eigenvalue around 2. I mean, we proved the semicircle law by the moment method, but one can improve on this to get at least some more information, which tells us a little bit about what happens around 2. Yeah, and so the main point there is to estimate probabilities that the eigenvalues are much larger than 2. Okay, so how to estimate the probability that the largest eigenvalue is, let's say, bigger than 2 plus epsilon. That's an interesting piece of information which tells us a lot about what happens about 2. Okay, so the question is, can we get something there which is better than what we did for the semicircle? Of course, for the semicircle law doesn't tell us anything about this. So we have somehow to improve what we did up to now. But we want to improve it in the same spirit. Okay, so we want to derive an estimate. And again, we do this in the case which has the nicest behavior, in the GUE case, where the Wick formula and all this is the nicest possible. In the GUE case, for the probability that the largest eigenvalue is greater or equal to 2 plus epsilon, 4 epsilons which we are free to choose. And we do this in general, so later we can also let epsilon depend on n. We want estimates which are also meaningful if epsilon depends on n. That will be the crucial thing. Different from what we did before. Before we maybe estimated such things, but the epsilon also did not depend on n. Yeah, and for estimating this, so if I want to do the moment method, I somehow have to go back to traces of powers. Because that's what the moment method is about. That's the thing which we can control, the expectation of traces of powers. So I should somehow relate this probability with the probability for traces of powers. Yeah, so what we want is an estimate for this, which actually is compatible with our heuristics that this epsilon should depend on n and is of the size n to the minus 2/3. So it should be an estimate which really gives us something for such a situation. So which is compatible with our heuristics that we should choose epsilon of the order n to the minus 2/3 times something which doesn't depend on epsilon anymore. Good, and for this, so we are looking now on an, so this is our GUE, and as before also in the pictures, we are looking on a normalized GUE, so that in the limit the spectrum is between minus 2 and plus 2, so an is normalized GUEn, so an n by n matrix. And what we want to do is we will refine our moment method. Okay, and so for this we consider for k, so we should take traces of power, so k will be the power. But we start with something where you don't see a trace and you don't see a power. So the question is what are we going to do? So we want to estimate that the largest eigenvalue is bigger than 2 plus epsilon. Good. Okay. And now, okay, we go now over to a power. Of course, we can take this inequality to the power k. So usually, I mean, if you're taking traces of powers, I mean, it's good to have all powers because different powers tell you different things. So instead of just looking on this, we just raise this to the power k. And so this is, of course, the same as the probability that, and actually I'm taking even powers, that lambda max to the 2k is bigger than 2 plus epsilon to the 2k. That's the same. All my quantities here are positive. Now we have a power, but now we want to go to the trace, and the trace is the sum of the eigenvalues. Here I only have one eigenvalue, but now I can estimate this by saying if I know that the largest eigenvalue is bigger than this, then the sum of all eigenvalues is bigger than this. And somehow the idea is that if I'm taking a sum of eigenvalues, the largest one should dominate this sum. Of course, if I'm just taking the sum, this is not true, but if I'm taking powers, then the power has on the largest eigenvalue, it has the biggest effect. So that's the reason why taking powers is a good thing. Because now, I mean, I'm replacing just the largest eigenvalue by the sum over all eigenvalues, but I still have the hope that the largest eigenvalue gives me the main contribution in this. So this estimate shouldn't be too bad, at least if I'm taking high powers of k. So this means I estimate this by, this is less than the probability where the sum over all eigenvalues to the power 2k is bigger than 2 plus epsilon to the 2k. Because here I have more situations where this is true. Because whenever this is true, this is also true. Good, okay, but now if I have the sum over the powers of the eigenvalues, this is now the same as the trace of the corresponding power of my matrix. So this here, so this is not a normalized sum, but just the ordinary sum. So this is n times the normalized trace of an to the power 2k. So this normalized trace is 1 over n times this sum here, over all the eigenvalues. Good, so what we have here, so we have estimated the probability in which we are interested against the probability for a trace of the power 2k of our matrices, that this is bigger than 2 plus epsilon to the 2k, and I should divide here by this n. Good. And now, I mean, calculating probabilities is not so easy for our matrices. What we can do is calculating expectations. And so we estimate such a probability that this random variable is bigger than something by the corresponding expectation. And this is the basic Markov inequality. So this is just saying that the probability that a positive random variable, but this is positive, that's also taking the power 2k is a good thing for this. So the probability that a positive random variable is bigger than something can be estimated by the expectation divided by this something. So this here we estimate now by the Markov inequality, very basic inequality, by 1 over this guy here, so which is n divided by 2 plus epsilon to the 2k, and then I take the expectation of my random variable, which is here the expectation of the trace of a n to the 2k. And now you see that we have related the probability of which you're interested about the largest eigenvalue against the expectation of a trace of a power. And that's things which we can do. And which we really did. Okay, but now we have to see whether this is really useful. So what we did, we had essentially a genus expansion for this. So we calculated this expectation here, and then for the semicircle law, it was only the leading order term which was relevant. So in chapter 2 somewhere, we calculated this genus expansion of exactly such things. So we calculated the expectation in terms of a genus expansion. And this was an exact formula. But of course, I mean, exact in the sense that we could write down names and symbols, but what we really could control was the leading order term. So what we have is this expectation of the trace of an to the power k. So this is given by summing, and we had to sum over pairings of 2k elements, so here we have power 2k, and then we get a contribution from each pairing, which is n to some power. So, namely concretely, it was n to the number of cycles of gamma pi. So we identify pi, which is a pairing with a permutation, by declaring the blocks to cycles, and gamma was this long shift, which just shifts everything by one. Okay, so this here is a permutation. We take the number of cycles, then we take minus k minus one. So I mean, there we had 2k was equal to m. So here we had m over 2. Okay, and of course, this thing here is what has a nice meaning. It's called the genus of the pairing. And it's actually really the genus where you can draw the pairing without having crossings. So if you collect now essentially the pairings which have the same genus, the same exponent here, I mean, then you get an expansion in n. So you can also write this as the sum over all g greater or equal to 0. And epsilon g of k is the number of pairings in 2k which have genus g. And then each of them makes the contribution n to the minus 2g. So this guy is a negative even number, so we write it as 2g. G is just an integer then, natural number, 0, 1, 2, and so on. So that was something which we did actually in 2.15, part 3. So that was the genus expansion, and maybe let me write down again what this epsilon g is. This is really counting the pairings of a given genus. And back then, the point was that we didn't need to know the epsilon g for g bigger than 1. The main point was only to understand the leading order terms. And of course, this will not be enough now, because now we want to know more, and then we also need more information about this. But so let us first see that this is actually the case, but let me just write down again explicitly. So epsilon gk, this is the number of pairings of 2k elements such that pi has genus g. And this really means, also having genus g really means that the number of cycles of gamma pi minus k minus 1 is equal to minus 2g. Okay, but this really has the concrete meaning that you can draw this pairing on a surface of genus g without crossings. G is the smallest genus for which you can do this. Genus equal to 0 really are the non-crossing pairings because you can draw them in a plane on the surface of a ball. Okay, good. Yeah, and so now so the inequality, so what we have now shown, so namely this inequality here, that the probability in which we are interested, that this is less than this, this is actually useless if we are now fixing k, if n goes to infinity. I mean, our moment method was really for the semicircle, we fixed the k, and then we looked on the trace of a to the power 2k, and we looked what is the limit if n goes to infinity for this, for each k. But k didn't depend on n. But you see, if we are doing this here, so if I have here my epsilon, then I have here 2 plus epsilon. This is just fixed. Let's say epsilon is fixed. But here I have an n which goes to infinity. And of course, this guy here just goes to the leading order, which is the Catalan number. So this means this side here just explodes. For any fixed k, this guy here just goes to infinity, which of course for probability is not a good estimate, because knowing probability is always less than 1. So if this here is getting bigger than 1, it's totally useless. So we really want something where this here is small. Okay, so this means what we did before, namely looking on traces of powers, but for a fixed power and then sending n to infinity, will not give us additional information on this guy here. Good. Okay, but I mean, we are free to choose k as we want, also epsilon if we like, and we can also let them depend on n. But of course, this means we have to understand more about this here. Yeah, so let me just say, so the inequality which we had there is useless if k is fixed. And we are sending n to infinity. And of course, we want n to infinity. We want this probability here for n going to infinity. Because then the right-hand side goes to infinity. So this means if we want to get something useful out of this, we should also scale the k. So hence, we have to scale k with n in a meaningful way. Okay, and it will turn out, we will see that having k proportional to n to the 2/3 is a good choice, which of course corresponds somehow to our heuristics. So what we are going to do is we can use this inequality where k depends on n in this way. Okay, but then of course, then if n goes to infinity, it's not only the leading order terms which will show up here, not only the genus zero terms, but the subleading order terms will also be important, which means we have to know more about them. For the semicircle law, we didn't have to know anything about them. But now we need more. So then, the subleading terms in this expectation of the trace of an to the 2k become important. Yeah, okay. And so we have to know something more about this. At the moment, we don't know this, but there's actually a theorem which tells us something about this, and this is this theorem by Hara and Sagie, which I already mentioned, I think, in the context of this, but now we really have to look more precisely into this. We have to use it. So yeah, it's subleading, and this is given by a theorem of Hara and Sagie. Yeah, okay, and I will write down this theorem and yeah, maybe give an example to show that it really makes an interesting statement, but then we are going to use it. But I will come back to it and I will prove it later. Okay, but not now. So I'm just writing it down and then using it to show you what we can get for this. Well, this is a quite amazing theorem. And this was proved by Hara and Sagie, I mean two mathematicians, at a time when random matrices were not really a big topic in mathematics. So I mean they really wanted to do something about the moduli space of something, and they used this random matrix for doing their calculations. They were not interested in random matrices. So here's the theorem. So this is by Hara and Sagie. And this was 1986. Really, I mean, even before Tracy Widdem and all this stuff was there. I mean, so in the 90s, maybe random matrices started to become a topic in mathematics. Before it was more in physics. Okay, but anyhow, they proved an important result there. So, yeah, essentially what they are doing is to have a kind of recursion between those epsilons. I mean, there is no explicit formula. For the leading order term, we know the epsilon zeros are just counting the non-crossing pairings, and this is given by the Catalan numbers. If you want to count the pairings which have genus 1 or the pairings which have genus 2, there is no real explicit formula. But what this theorem provides is a recursion between various of those quantities. So, and for this, we define, instead of the epsilons, we are looking on numbers bk, which we define by saying that the sum over g greater than 0, epsilon gk times n to the minus 2k, and that's really the quantity in which we are interested. That's our expectation of the trace to the power 2k. So, I mean, this is given in leading order by the ck, and then we say the correction terms, we just put them in the multiplicative correction and call it bk. So bk is just this here divided by the Catalan numbers. Those are the Catalan numbers. Yeah, good. And of course, you should note that this bk depends on n. I mean, I could put an n somewhere, but it should be clear. I mean, the epsilon k here, they don't depend on n. I mean, the n dependence is here. Okay, and also the cks don't depend on n. But the bks depend on n, just to be clear on this. And then, okay, what is the statement? So this is just a definition of the bks. Then we have a recursion between them. Then we have the recursion that bk plus 1, you can write it in terms of bk and bk minus 1, so namely it is equal to bk plus, and then you have k times k plus 1 divided by 4n squared times bk minus 1 for all k bigger or equal to 2. Good. Okay, so this is maybe, yeah, not obvious, surprising statement, and maybe I will give the proof later. I mean, the proof needs some time. It's not just an easy thing. Okay, but I will do it later, but maybe now we just check this statement that it is true for small k, because we know essentially some of the values of the epsilon k's. So we can calculate the corresponding B's and see that they satisfy this. So we take k, yeah, we compare, I think, so this is for k bigger than 2, so we take k equal to 2, so we compare B3 with B2 and B1, huh? So we need B2, B1 and B3. Yeah, so let us just do this example. 9.6 is an example. Okay, so we will prove this later. So now we check it for small values. And you should look back on 2.14, where essentially we talked a little bit about this. So what is B1? So according to this, the definition, just according to the definition, so if k is equal to 1, then I have C1 times B1. This is the expectation of the trace of An to the power 2k, which is here 2. And of course, the trace of this guy we know is 1. Okay, because there's only one pairing which has contribution 1. This is 1. And C1, of course, is also 1. So this tells us B1 is equal to 1. For the second moment, there is no correction. Good. More interesting. So the fourth moment, we are writing the fourth moment now as C2 times B2. So this is the fourth moment, expectation of the trace of An to the power 4. And there we have seen, I mean, there are three pairings of four elements. Two of them are non-crossing. They are giving the contribution 2, but the other one has genus 1, so it gives a contribution 1 over n squared. Okay, yeah. And so this means the C2 is the leading order term, that's the 2. So this means B2 is now just this divided by 2, which is 1 plus 1 divided by 2n squared. Good. Okay, and what is C3? Okay, I think we go up to B4, because maybe only then it's really getting a bit interesting. So what is B3? That's the expectation of the sixth power of my GUE. There we have 15 pairings, 5 of them are non-crossing, and one can check easily that the other 5 all have genus 1. So we have the other 10, so we have 10 times 1 over n squared. Okay, and so this means the B3 is this divided by the Catalan number, which is 5. So I get here, this is 1 plus 10 divided by 2 is 2 over n squared. Okay, and let me also do 4. So this is the expectation of power 8. There are 105 pairings. 14 of them are non-crossing, and the other ones, some of them have genus 1, some of them have genus 2. Okay, I mean, I told you what it is. I think nobody of us ever really checked them all, but in principle we could check all those 105. So it's namely 70 have genus 1, so they give a contribution 1 over n squared, and the remaining 21 have genus 2, which means they give a contribution 1 over n to the 4. And this means, of course, the B4 is now this divided by 14, which is 1 plus 5, 1 over n squared, plus 3 over 2, 1 over n 4. Good. Okay, so those are the four, B1, B2, B3, and B4. Okay, just because of this expansion. And now I want to check this here actually for k equal to 3. So I compare B4 with B3 and B2. And I mean, those look, I don't know, arbitrary numbers, but they have, there's some relation between them, but which is not obvious. It's not just cutting something into something else. So this is not a simple combinatorial statement. So we check 9.5 for k equal to 3. So what should we take there? We should take b3 plus this times b2 and see that this is b4. So let us take b3 and then I take k times k plus 1. K is here 3, so I have 3 times 4 divided by 4n squared multiplied with b2. And this should be b4. But so let us plug in b3 and b2. So b3 was 1 plus 2 over n squared. And then I have, 3 over n squared times b2. And b2 is 1 plus 1 over 2n squared. And now let's check, hopefully, that we get the right thing. So I have the 1 here. So how many n squares do I have? I have here 2 over n squared. I have here 3 over n squared. So I get 5 over n squared. And then I also have n to the power 4. And I have it 3 over 2. Plus 3 over 2, 1 over n 4. And you see, hopefully, that this is exactly what I have for b2. Okay. But I don't think you see any reason why those guys have to combine in this way. So, okay, so at least it might be surprising and not clear where it comes from, but at least I think we have now enough confidence that it is true. And I'm now going to use it to get an estimate for the expectation which we want. So I'm now using this recursion to derive the following corollary. That's the main thing which we need for estimating our probability. So namely, getting an estimate of our expectation of the trace to the power k. So I still need this. So the corollary is this following estimate so namely for all n and k natural numbers we have for our unitary Gaussian ensemble we have for GUE n, which I denote by an, that I can estimate this expectation of the trace of an to the power 2k. I can estimate this by the Catalan numbers, that's the leading order term, which would only play a role if this is kept fixed. But then I can be more precise on the correction term, so namely this is given by e to the k over 3 divided by 2n squared. So this is true for any k and n. And you see that this somehow goes nice and tells me what I should choose for k. Because if n goes to infinity, of course I can say, if n goes to infinity, I keep k fixed. But then this here goes to infinity. And then this doesn't tell me anything. So I want to choose k in such a way that this quantity here also stays somehow bounded, goes to something. And you see this tells me k to the power 3 should go like n squared. Good, but let us check that this is true. So this is a consequence of this Hara-Sagier recursion. So again, where ck, here are the Catalan numbers. So let us prove this. Yeah, so first of all, I mean, all the b's which we have there are positive. That's clear from the definition, because all these expectations are positive, and the Catalan numbers are positive. So note that by definition, all the bk's are bigger than zero, and this means that the sequence of the bk's is increasing, because I mean, the bk plus 1 is the bk plus something, and but this is positive and this is also positive. So they are increasing. We have already used this recursion formula. I mean, from the definition it's not clear that they are increasing, but this recursion in particular tells this. So by 9.5 we have that bk plus 1 is bigger than bk. Okay, and now I want to estimate I have to estimate the bk's, Yeah, so we have bk plus 1. Let me write down the recursion for Sagier. So this is bk plus k times k plus 1 divided by 4n squared bk minus 1. Okay, and now I use this estimate that this guy here is less than bk. So I can simplify this here by just writing here bk and also here bk. And then it's getting simpler, and I think I don't need Hara-Sagier now anymore. I have used it for the main step, so let me erase it. So I write it, maybe I continue. Here I write it less than bk, and then I have 1 from the first term, and k times k plus 1 divided by 4n squared from the second term. I estimated this less than bk, or less or equal. Good, okay, and then maybe I also want to simplify this here a little bit. K and k plus 1 is maybe not so nice. I want to compare this to k squared. But of course I can say, so this is k squared plus k. I can say this is less than 2k squared. So I can estimate this against bk. And here, this quantity here, I replace by k squared divided by then 2n squared. I have estimated this against 2k squared. Good, and then I can, so you see I have now, there is something wrong. I have estimated bk plus 1 against bk with such a term. And then of course I can iterate this and estimate bk against bk minus 1 with a corresponding term and so on. So I can estimate the bk against the smaller ones until I arrive at the initial point. So I estimate, and let's say I estimate now the bk, not the bk plus 1. So this is less than so this here tells me it's less than the bk minus 1 times this guy here, but now the k of course is k minus 1. K minus 1 squared divided by 2n squared. Okay, then I have here bk minus 1, and I estimate this against bk minus 2, which I get with this term, where the k is now k minus 2. So I have 1 plus k minus 2 squared up to 2n squared. And I'm just go so on, I multiply all those terms until I arrive at b1. And for this, the last term is 1 plus, and here I have then, I suppose, 1 squared divided by 2n squared. Good, and you see I have here a product of guys where this case here are decreasing. And again, I just want to write this in a nicer form. I just estimate each of those terms here against 1 plus, I take the biggest term which I have here. Actually, I take k squared instead of k minus 1 squared. I estimate all of those terms here against k squared so that I can write this here as less than, I have here k terms, and each of them is less than 1 plus k squared divided by 2n squared to the power k. Good, and now I estimate this against the exponential function. So I'm just estimating this term here. So this is 1 plus something, 1 plus x, and I just estimate this is less than e to the x, because 1 plus x is the beginning of the Taylor series in 1 plus x, and all the terms are positive because things here are positive. So I estimate this against exp of this guy here, k squared 2 divided by n squared. But this is just the inner thing, and then I have the power k. So I have this whole thing to the power k. So I have e to the power of this to the power k, which means I'm just multiplying k here inside, which is then the exponential of k to the power 3 divided by 2n squared. And that's what I want to prove, because the bk is this expectation divided by ck. And so we have seen that this is less than e to the power k over k to the power 3 2 divided by 2n squared. Okay, so this is the, this is the application of this Harasaki formula. Good, and maybe this is now a good point to stop, because now we should apply this to our estimate for the largest eigenvalue. So we had this estimate, the probability that the largest eigenvalue is bigger than 2 plus epsilon was estimated against the expectation of a trace to some power. And now we can use this estimate and then try to choose the k and maybe also the epsilon in the right way so that we get a meaningful statement. But maybe that's what we are going to do next time. And then of course at some point, not sure whether this will be next time but maybe the following, I will also prove Hara and Sagi. But we have already used it. Good, okay, so that's it for today. Thanks.